Yeah. Father, tonight we thank you for your goodness and for your faithfulness. Tonight, Heavenly Father, we've come to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor that is due unto your name. You brought us here safely. You provided for us. You protected us. Heavenly Father, you've kept us safe from disease. Lord, you've kept our families together. You've kept our minds intact. We honor you, dear God. We invite your Holy Ghost into this worship service even now. To bring transformation, Heavenly Father. To revive us. To show us your grace, your mercy, and your tender kindness. Today, as we worship you, the Heavenly Father, create within us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. So as we worship you, let us worship you in spirit and in truth. To your name's honor and to your glory. For Christ's sake we pray. Amen.
Oh, don't sit just yet, don't sit just yet. Let's go to my new task just now. One that I'm more than happy to do is to welcome each and every one of you in the wonderful, magnificent, and loving name of Jesus Christ himself. We're going to move around just now. You haven't seen some folks since yesterday. Every praise is to our God. You can sing that right now.
Yeah. going to bless our hearts with our first special would be Mistress Anisca Taylor Simon.
I almost said happy Sabbath.
Thank you. and I went out today and I did some little trinket shopping. And we want to give Sister Kim and Pastor Jeremy Arnold tokens of our love and appreciation all in Bahamian. All right. All right. Yeah. We're going to take them on the bike for everybody to see. So our first gift that we found for Sister Kim was a bag that has Bahamian, the blue marlin fish, and then the little tower. And we have a wallet that complements it. Then we got some hats that has Bahamas on it. Then we got some keychains for you to put on your key to symbolize and remember us.
Yeah.
And we also got the refrigerator case to put in the kitchen. And then we got the bathhouse to put in your bath. Love on the island that she put on. Amen. Smell and remember us. Yeah. We want to say thank you.
Yes.
We want the audience to know that this is a impromptu, that's the right word.
Yes.
Okay. He would have been here for a wedding and our guest speaker on Sabbath. And we asked for him to give us one more sermon before he leaves, which is tomorrow morning. So this is it tonight. So we want to thank you for your support, and we want to give them as much love as we possibly can to help them to come back very soon in 2020. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the service. And then we have Mark. I had to exchange it from a blue marlin to an American because I know he wouldn't be able to spend it. So this is actually a bill for him to remember us as well, him to buy something nice for him and Sister Kim that is Bahamian.
Sister Mary Sue has given a whole lot of hint. Hint, Pastor. As she has said, it would not be possible if Pastor Alvarico Moss did not give consent and that Pastor Jeremy did not, you know, allow himself to be used by the Spirit to accept this invitation. I know sometimes when we go other places to do other things, we like to, you know, just chill and relax, but this man is not like that. Whenever God calls him, he responded and is happy to share the word. Pastor Jeremy Arnold is the pastor of the Andrews Church. Andrews is like the Centerville of the Bahamas. The Andrews in St. Andrews, Jamaica. And he's doing a wonderful job there. And we love Pastor Jeremy. Amen?
Amen.
He spent a week with us and he just worked himself into our hearts. And
yes.
We just can't, you know, we just want to have more and more of Pastor Arnold. And he's passionate. I don't know if charismatic it should be the word to use. He just loves Jesus. And whenever he speaks, we just feel the Spirit moving and it speaks to our hearts. So tonight, he's going to be speaking with us again what God has laid on his heart. And Sister Kim, you know the word haul and pull, right? Yeah, you saw they were hauling and pulling in yesterday. You know, everybody wants to get pastors here. That's the kind of loving person he is. And he always have a word to give. And we are just inching there to hear what God has placed on your heart again tonight. And we are praying for your ministry in Jamaica, that you will prosper and do well. But before Pastor comes, I have a very special person who will sing again.
Yes.
Sister Aniska Tanis, one courageous young woman.
Yes.
One who loved God and one who loved people. She has passed through situations that a lot of people will have fold up. But God is standing with her. I don't know if you want to share a little of her experience. This is, you know, with us today. Because she has gone through a whole lot, but God has been with her, and her music is a way of bridging that gap and bringing solace to our hearts. Sister, we just love you. We are happy to have you here. And you know that Pastor is just ready to go. But we love you, and the mic is yours.
I would say that God is still a good God.
Yes, yes.
And I don't know about you, but I long for Jesus to come again.
Yes.
This world is not our home. We are just pilgrims passing through. And so I look forward to the day when there'll be no more night. There'll just be pure day. We're basking in the rays of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Oh boy. I don't need to preach after that. I can sit down, can all go home. Sister Aniska Taylor Tennis, thank you so much. May God bless you richly and may you continue to sing for the Lord. Because soon and very soon, there will be no more light. And I cannot wait for that day when we're not plagued with sin and temptation. The devil will finally get what he deserves. And so I encourage us to remain faithful to the Lord. I want to thank you for the short notice to be here tonight. You're making it very difficult for me because now I want to stay in Bahamas. I am so thankful. My elder, thank you for your kind words of introduction. Thank you. I want to thank Brother and Sister Rami for their hospitality to me and my wife and putting up with me. Sister Marissa, for not stopping until she got exactly what she wanted. I thank you so much. I want to thank you for the gifts. We weren't expecting, but that's how God worked.
Yes.
We want to say thank you for me and my wife. We really do appreciate it. Now, our home will be advertising for Bahamas. There is something for every part of the home. Thank you so much. I just want to thank the Lord for his word. And also I want to bring to your mind the announcement of your pastor Moss. He wanted to be here, but given his new experience, it's very challenging. He had an emergency that, you know, did not permit him to be here, but he sends his greetings, his love. And I want to thank him. Please convey for me and my wife our appreciation for his willingness to allow us to be here. And also he wants to remind us that tomorrow at 4 o'clock p.m., that service will be here as we close the curtain to 2019 and enter into 2020. Anya, I see you, girl. I see you. I see you. I am thankful for all of you. No, I don't preach long anymore. But I need you to understand the message. So I will close as soon as everybody understands the message. And that is not a problem because understanding is the work of the Holy Ghost. And so we don't have to invite God here because where two or three are gathered, there he is in the midst. Bless. I want to speak to you tonight from the caption, "It's time to do things God's way."
Amen.
As we enter 2020, I believe it is high time for us to do things God's way.
Oh, yeah.
Shall we bow our heads for prayer? Great God and our Heavenly Father, we are grateful and we are thankful for Jesus. We are thankful that we can come to you in his name. And when you look down, God, you don't see dirty Jeremy, but you see the blood of Jesus. Tonight, oh God, I want to ask you to move within this place to shake every stronghold and shake until everyone is broken down. I ask, oh God, that as we experience you tonight and we leave from here, may those whom we come in contact with say without any doubt that they have been with Jesus.
Amen.
Oh Father, like John the Baptist, I decrease so that you may increase.
Oh, yeah.
Speak tonight, for your servants are listening, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. Question: how many of you believe that you are at a place where God wants you to be? How many of you believe that you're at a place where you are to be? I want to speak to you from, we're going to use four different passages, both Old and New Testament, and two old, two new, and I want us to understand that God worked in mysterious ways.
Yeah.
And I want to challenge us tonight that where we are right now, let me ask a question. How many of you are going through a storm right now? Let me see that. There's some things in my life, Pastor, that is just horrible right now, and you're going through a storm right now. I want to challenge you that you're exactly where God wants you to be.
Amen.
I want to challenge you that where you are right now is still according to God's divine blueprint.
Yeah.
For the only way out of God's divine blueprint is death.
Wow. So true.
So as long as there is life, you're still within the parameters of God's divine blueprint.
Yes.
You don't believe me, so let me get into the word. Let me get into the word. Go with me to the book of John. What book did I say? That's John chapter, Luke. Let's go to Luke. What book did I say? Luke chapter 7. You find Matthew, you find Mark, and then you find Luke. Luke chapter 7. And I will read in your hearing from verse 11. Because of time, just listen as I read. Now it happened the day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and a large crowd. And when he came near the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was already a widow. And a large crowd from the city was with her. Verse 13. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came and touched the open coffin, and those who carried him stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." So he who was dead sat up and began to speak, and he presented him to his mother, and he presented him to his mother, and he presented him to his mother, and he presented him to his mother. I wish somebody was with me. And he presented him to his mother. He presented him to his mother. Then fear came upon all. This is after he presented him to his mother. And they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen up among us, and God has visited his people." And this report about him went throughout all Judea and the surrounding region. Before I speak of this woman and her calamity, permit me to just speak to you and give you a little history of his name. In the early part of chapter 7, Jesus, a centurion worker, was sick, and this servant was on the point of death, and he sent for Jesus, for he heard about Jesus. He wasn't a believer, he just heard about this Jesus. And he said, ask Jesus to come here, because this centurion, he was a leader. And so Jesus complied, and he was going there, and the centurion sent message to him, and the centurion came and said, hey, the message I've heard, I don't think I am worthy for you to come into my home. This was not a believer. This is somebody who only heard about Jesus. And the Bible says that the centurion said, if you just speak the word from here, my servant who is sick to the point of death will be healed. And the Bible says that Jesus marveled. Jesus marveled because he said, I have seen no such faith, not even in Israel. The day after, he went to Nain. Now here's the history of Nain. Nain is a city that is on a hill. The gate or the entrance to that city is down to the ground. The cemetery is 8 to 10 miles from the city gate. In order to get to the city, you have to go down to the ground in order to enter the city to get to the cemetery. No, you're not with me.
Yes, yes. Go ahead.
The city of Nain, it is on a hill. The entrance to that city is down to the ground. In order to get into the city, you must go down so that you can get into the city. Okay, you're not getting it. But let me try over here. The city of Nain, it's on a hill. The entrance to that city is down to the ground. And the Bible says that Jesus met the woman at the entrance to the city. The city of Nain is on a hill. The Bible says that Jesus met this woman at the entrance to the city. Come on now. In order to get into the city, to walk 8 to 10 miles, you have to go through the entrance, but the entrance is down to the ground. You know, I think I am feeling it now. The Bible says that Jesus met the woman not in the city, but Jesus met the woman at the entrance of the city, which is not up, but which is down to the ground. Jesus did not meet the woman while she was up in the city. The Bible says that Jesus met her at the entrance, which is down to the ground. It is amazing that we treat people bad when they are low to the ground. We disfellowship people when they are low to the ground. But the Bible says that Jesus met this woman at the entrance of the city that was down to the ground. That's why I can say tonight that you are, if you're in a storm, if you're down to the ground, you're about to meet Jesus. Because Jesus, there is something about Jesus. He never comes when we're up there. Talk to me, somebody. But when the woman was down to the ground, the Bible said that she met Jesus at a place where she's at her lowest. It reminds me of the woman who was caught in adultery, and everybody came to stone her, and she was on the ground. But the Bible says, watch this, Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground. But here's what we miss. He didn't stoop down just to write. He stooped down to reach where the woman was. Because in order to elevate somebody, you need to go down. Jesus made this woman to the ground. And Jesus met her. The Bible says that a crowd was with the woman. In this crowd, there were professional mourners. People who were hired to cry. People who were hired to just be mournful. And the Bible also said in verse 11 that there was a crowd with Jesus. So at this intersection, at the entrance to the city that is on a hill, the entrance is down to the ground, two crowds intersecting. A crowd which was following the woman, and a crowd which was following Jesus. In these two crowds, there were two sons. The son of this widow who was there. And then the son of the living God. There was a son who was being taken to the silent city of the grave. And then there was a son who was getting ready to be taken to the silent city of the grave. You didn't get that. Let me bring it back. The two crowds intersected. In the two crowds, there were two sons. One of the sons were being carried to the silent city of the grave.
Yes.
But when they met Jesus, he who was being carried to the grave is about to leave.
Yes.
But then there was another son who was alive but was getting ready to be carried to the silent city of the grave. Not only were there two crowds or two sons, but there were two enemies. Death and life. To me, somebody.
Yes.
There were two enemies.
Yes.
Death following the woman,
yes,
and life following Jesus.
Yes.
And I am happy to tell you that when death and life meet, somebody has to give up.
Yes.
Somebody has to pay part.
Yes.
Somebody has to give way,
yes,
because when life shows up, death must flee. And there were two cities represented here. You have the city of Nain with the woman. Then you have the city of heaven represented in the person of Jesus.
Yes,
I don't think you get that what's happening here.
Oh, yes. Yes.
For every challenge, there is a solution.
Yes.
For every difficulty, there is a Jesus.
Yeah.
And it is amazing that this woman going through everything, all the hardship, the turmoil, the mourning, she was easily identified because she would have torn her outer garment,
yeah,
as a woman in mourning. And the Bible says it was there that Jesus, she didn't recognize Jesus. She wasn't even looking for Jesus. Her reality had overwhelmed her. But the Bible says that Jesus saw her. We don't need to see him. He saw us. And the Bible says he drew near unto the woman. And he said, daughter, cease crying. Because I am the resurrection and the life. And the Bible says that Jesus did something that everybody marveled at. He touched the bear. He touched the coffin. But here's what he missed. If a Jew touched something that is touching a dead, that Jew is ceremonially unclean. He didn't get it.
Yes.
Jesus touched the dead, made himself ceremonially unclean. He became sin for us. And the Bible says that he called the young man up and said, arise. And he gave back the boy to his mother. The Bible says that the people were fearful. They have never seen this. It is amazing. It is amazing that Jews are governed by moral and ceremonial laws. And Jesus, being a Jew, went against everything that a Jew would stand for. And I cannot close without telling you that the God that we serve is a God who is not limited by man's standard.
Amen.
We don't serve a God who only fellowship. Boy, I will get in trouble for this one. We don't serve a God who only fellowship at the Adventist Church. We serve a God who is the Lord of all the world. And this God is not partial. He says that whosoever believes should not perish, but everlasting life. And I want us to understand tonight that this God oftentimes communicates to us through our hardship. I didn't get that. This God is a God who reaches near to us when we are messed up. You need another Bible illustration. In Exodus chapter 33 and verse 22, here in the context, Moses said, God, I will not leave until I see your glory. God said, Moses, you can't see me. No man see me and live. Moses said, well, that's your problem, because if I don't see you, I'm not going anywhere. And God said, okay, Moses, you want to see my glory? I will put you in the cleft of the rock, and I will pass by, and you will see my glory. And here's what we miss. How many of you have seen the cleft of a rock? It is a hard place. It is a rough place. It is not a comfortable place. No, you didn't get that. In order for Moses to see the glory of God, Moses must enter a place of discomfort. In order for Moses to see the glory of God, Moses must enter a place of hardship. In order for you to see the glory of God, the storms in our lives are necessary. Because God manifests himself through storms. We see the glory of God through hardship. You don't believe me? It was Jacob. Jacob, the Bible says, wrestled with God, but before that, he fell asleep on a rock. A rock is not soft, it is hard. How tired must you be to fall asleep on a rock? But it was in this encounter, in this experience rather, that he encountered God. In a hard place. In a difficult place. In a disturbing place. Oftentimes in a suicidal place. Oftentimes in a depressing place. For I remember many years ago when I tried killing myself. And I tied the rope on the beam of the house. I climbed on the two-story house, the rail of that house, and put the rope around my neck, getting ready to leap. Because the hardship of life can become so real that everywhere you look, you're only seeing rocks. You're in the cliff. It was a hard place. There was rocks all around me, not understanding that it was God who deliberately put me in that hard place to show his glory. I remember when I was getting ready to leave, a man ran up the stair and held on to to one of my foot and said, "Don't jump." He said, "Look, God, there's a plane." He said, "I promise I will take you places." I looked to see this man because I didn't recognize the boy. But when I looked, there was nobody there, but I still felt the holding on my feet. Had it not been for a hard place, I would not have experienced that man who I've come to know to be Jesus Christ. This is the God that we serve. This is the God that we serve. I need to tell you something quickly, though. When Jesus came, they didn't understand his purpose. John the Baptist saw him as a candidate for water baptism. Jesus came and Judas saw him as a means to make a quick buck. The scribes and Pharisees saw him as a demoniac. Rome saw him as a heretic. So when Jesus came, he was misunderstood. Up to this very day, the Son of God is still misunderstood. You have different cliques and sects and churches who pull him and said, "No, he only belongs here, and he only belongs here." And you need to understand that earth is the footstool of God, and amen. Jesus is beyond. He transcends his creation. Amen. So he belongs to no one party. He's the God for everybody. Amen. He was misunderstood. Watch this. In their misunderstanding of Jesus, you know, spiritual things are spiritually discerned.
Yeah, yeah.
You can talk spiritual without being spiritual enough.
Yes. Oh, yes.
You can look spiritual without being spiritual. You can sing spiritual.
Yes, sir.
You can preach spiritual.
Yes, sir.
You can pretend to be spiritual without really being spiritual, because until you come in contact with Jesus and accept him, you are not spiritual. Position don't make
spiritual.
Let me stay in context.
My Lord,
baptism don't make you spiritual. You're spiritual when you come in contact with Jesus. Let me give you another example. In John 4, there is a woman at the well, and she had a problem, and all sort of things was going on, and Jesus said, she said, "Hey, we heard stories about a man who will come, and all fathers worship in this mountain." Jesus said, "Stop it right there. For the time is coming when they that worship me will worship me in spirit and in truth." It has nothing to do with location. It has everything to do with an experience with Jesus. And Jesus performed miracles. What he did, he committed in the minds of the people the unpardonable sin. This was what led to the death of Jesus. In John chapter 2, follow with me. In John chapter, I'm going somewhere, just wait a minute. John chapter 2, verses 18 to 20, the Bible says, "So the Jews answered and said to him, 'What sign do you show to us since you do these things?' Jesus answered and said to them, 'Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up.'" Verse 20. Then the Jews said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days." That's not bad. Look at Matthew 27. Matthew 27, verse 39 and 40. Listen, look at what the Bible says. Then the soldiers, Matthew 27, verses 20, verses 39 and 40, right? And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads, saying, "You who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself! If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." The sin in the minds of the people that Jesus did was when they took Jesus and in Matthew 13 there, and they showed him the temple, the magnificence of the temple, and they said, "Jesus, look at the marbles, look at the gold, look at all of these things." And Jesus, "Look at the temple, watch this, look at the temple," pointed it now at himself and said, "Let me tell you this, not one stone shall be left upon another that will not be thrown down." They got upset because you can't say anything, but dare not speak against the temple. For the temple, watch this, the temple was a conduit through which the spiritual leaders communed with God. Yes. To disrespect the temple is to disrespect God. You will be killed if you disrespect the temple. As a matter of fact, you read in Nehemiah when Ezra and Nehemiah and his companions it was important that they build the temple, because if the temple is not rebuilt, Messiah cannot come. So the temple had great significance. And when Jesus came, he looked at the temple and he said, "Oh, that's nothing. I will break that up. I will ensure that not one stone be left upon another." And then he began speaking and they showed him the temple again. And Jesus said, "I will destroy the temple. And then I will build it back up in 3 days." Jesus, what's wrong with you? It took almost 70 years to build this temple, and you will destroy it and rebuild it. From he said that, they sought to kill him. Mm-hmm. Here is it. Jesus, the temple rather, pointed to Jesus. The temple is only relevant when Jesus is in it. Yes. Walk with. The furniture of the temple pointed to Jesus. The furniture is there only relevant because they symbolize he who is to come. It is Jesus who makes the temple important. Without Jesus, the temple is void. It is Jesus that makes the temple relevant. Without Jesus, the temple is void. So watch this. When they rejected Jesus, they made void the temple. Because if the temple should be important, Jesus must be in it. I'm going somewhere. So when they rejected Jesus, they made void by their own choices, not by the choice of Jesus, but by their own choices, they made void the temple. You didn't get that.
All right.
The Bible says that our body is the temple of the living God. When we reject Jesus, we make void the temple. Our temple is only important when Jesus is in it. If Jesus is not in our temple, we may void the body. Are you understanding me? Are we committing the same grievous sin that the people then did? For by rejecting Jesus, they made void the temple. But our body, the Bible says, is the temple of the living God. And when Jesus is in the temple, then we are relevant. When Jesus is in the temple, then we are important. If we reject Jesus, we reject our own selves. I'm gonna close now. It's time to do things God's way. Question, do you understand who we are? Do you understand who you are? Do we understand who we are? I am challenged because I think the reason for hypocrisy and gossip and backbiting and jealousy and competition and comparison it is because we don't understand who we are. Not only are we the city set on a hill, not only are we the city of refuge, but I need you to understand more detailed than that. We in Jeremiah chapter 18, we don't need to turn there. God was getting ready to give Jeremiah a message of hope to the people. So he said to Jeremiah, Jeremiah, I want you to go to this address. When you get there, you will see a house. I want you to go in because that is a potter's house. And when you get in there, you will recognize somebody. And as soon as you recognize that person, I will give you a message. Jeremiah listened. He went in and he saw a potter sitting and he's making something at the wheel. And as he recognized the potter, God said, Now I want you to know that I am that potter. And Israel is the clay, marred in my hand. But tell Israel I'm still working on them. Israel believed God had abandoned them. I need you to tell Israel that I showed you a potter and I likened this potter unto myself, and I want you to tell them that the potter had a clay in his hand. He was making a vessel, but that vessel was marred. Tell Israel that I will make for myself another vessel. That though they are messed up, they are still in the potter's hand. But deeper than that, when you read Ezekiel 2 was given a message of hope. God took Ezekiel and showed him himself. But Ezekiel took a while to recognize God. He saw seraphim. He saw beasts. He saw the throne. He saw wheels going that way. Wheels going the other way. He saw all these things that looked like confusion. And when he fixed his eyes carefully, the Bible says that he saw two hands. And they were the hands of a man. In the midst of the confusion, the hands of God was right there. You didn't get it.
Yes.
Whenever God reveals himself to humanity, he takes on the form of humanity. Emmanuel. God with us in human form. Are you walking? I'm going somewhere.
Yes.
Jesus in Matthew 25 and verse 40 said that he will inform those who were obedient that when I was hungry, you gave me food. When I was thirsty, you gave me water. When I was in prison, you visited me. When I was naked, you gave me clothes. And the question was, Lord, when did we do this to you? And Jesus said, the least you do unto me to say, we are the potter's hand.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
That's why there are messed up people in our lives. Because the potter is constantly working. Oh, you're not with me. When Jesus, all right, let me give you another example. In John 13, when Jesus was getting ready to leave and getting ready to say goodbye to his disciples, he's about to be persecuted. The Bible says he took up a towel. Not title. Not position. Not an office. But he took a towel. He poured water in a basin. And he began to wash the feet of the disciples.
Yes, yes.
Their feet was dirty. Which was a reflection of their spiritual life.
Oh, yes.
When he got to Simon Peter, Simon Peter said, Lord, what are you doing? Jesus said, washing your feet. He said, you will never wash my feet. Jesus said, you don't understand now, but after you will understand. And Peter, if I wash you not, you have no part with me. And Peter saw his condition, realized that indeed he was in need of washing. And he said, Lord, not only my feet, because I am dirty all over, wash me, beat me. And when we see our condition, when we see our condition, it becomes personal between you and Jesus. You don't see nobody else. But watch this. What drew Jesus to wash the feet of the disciples? He could have said to them, thy sins be forgiven you. He had done that before.
Yeah.
But why did he do this?
Set an example.
Yes, he set an example of humility and love. But he's the potter.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
The potter. Oh, God, thank you, Jesus. I didn't see this. Thank you. Watch this. The potter did not expose their dirt. The potter came to where the dirt is. Because a potter's greatest work comes from dirt. And so he came to where the dirt was. He knelt down and he began to wash the dirt. He's making for himself another vessel. He's washing and cleaning the feet, cleaning the lives of the disciples. They did not understand, but look at the master teacher teaches. He said, now go do likewise. You are the potter's hand. We're not here to expose nobody's dirt. We are here to take a towel, come on somebody, and to wash each other. This is the work of the church. This is the work of Christians. This is the work that God has left for us to do. Oh, good God, I need to close now. It's time to do things God's way. God, for God did not run when man messed up. The Bible says he came looking for man. When we experience Jesus, when we accept Jesus, Jesus expects for us to be the potter's hand on earth. How are you dealing with that marred clay in your life? How patient are you with your wife, with your husband, with your children, with the church? For the potter is drawn by mess, and he makes a vessel. from that mess.
Oh, yes.
Are you with me tonight? We're not here for positions or for the titles. Oh, I'm the first and I am the second and I am the clerk. I am the, that is not important. In the last days of earth, Jesus did not take a title, but he took a power. Servant leadership is needed for 2020. God is still waiting for somebody who will take a towel, who will see the mess, but instead of exposing it, gossiping about it, they clean it.
Oh, yeah.
All
right.
Oh, Jesus. He cleaned us up. He's attracted by dirt to clean us up. Paul says, if any man know being Christ, he's a new creature. Old things, that's it. Old things, exposing someone else's dirt. All things are passed away. Behold, take up a towel, for all things have become new. I pray tonight that we understand who we are. And when we accept Jesus, we become the potter's hand. Not my will, but thy will be done. You know, I'm just going to give you the short version. I close now, I promise. I dare not testify. I thank God for Jesus. And I have learned daily that there are some things that the Lord put you through that have nothing to do with you. We personalize the struggles, and like Paul, we pray three times for the Lord to remove the thorn, and the Lord said, no, it's not about you, so I'm going to leave the thorn there, because it is in your weakness that I am made strong. And the reason the Lord, I got in trouble for this question, I pray that you don't hate me now. Question, will God give you more than you can bear? Think before you answer that one. Will God give you more than you can bear? Mm-hmm. The answer that softer now. Think about it. Will God give you more than you can bear? Yes, I know what 1 Corinthians 10 says, that the Lord will not give you more than you can bear, and with every temptation there is a way of escape. I know what he's saying, but listen, look carefully at the text. The text says that with every temptation, he provides a way of what? Escape. If you can bear it, do you need a way of escape? So will God give you more than you can bear?
Yes.
Yes. All right, let's go. This is I started the gym and wanted to develop muscles, and they started me at 5 pounds, and after 3 days they had 5 more pounds, and after 3 days they had 10 more pounds, and I asked the instructor, I said, why are you doing this, the trainer? He said, because in order to develop muscle, we must add weight. If that is true for the physical, how much so it is for the spiritual, that in order to develop spiritual muscles, the Lord has to add our weight. Come on, somebody. And I am here to tell you, even live stream, that God will give you more than you can bear. Why? Because it wasn't for you to bear it alone. If you can bear it, you don't need God. Talk to me, somebody. But the reason life gets challenging and each day becomes harder and harder, it is God shouting from the balconies of heaven, saying, hey, look up for your redemption. Draw it nigh. Call unto me. For he alone can bear all burdens for us. Take my yoke. Give me your burdens. And the problem is that we personalize it and say, this is my cross. This is, I must carry it. And a part of carrying a cross simply means to give it to Jesus. Yes. 20. Let us give the struggles to Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
I was born prematurely. Was never supposed to be here. Mom was 5 months pregnant when she gave birth. And the doctor, they knew her well because she was frequent there. She had 10 children before. And she was frequent there. She was a frequent visitor at the hospital to give birth. Poor black woman. If she shouldn't do anything, she shouldn't give birth. She's not in a condition to care for the children. Can I testify?
Yes.
We grew up in a two-story wooden structure house that was so old that the house took on the shape of an S. People called it the sexy house. When we would be taken home or dropped off at home, we would stop a block down the road because you dare not let people see that you live there. It wasn't a condition. It wasn't a condition for any human being to live. The house was rat infested. Rat used to eat us alive. No electricity. No running water. And to compel all of this, here mommy pregnant again. With this complicated case now, because the reason for my early entrance in the world was an act of my father, who was sleeping with a prostitute. Got an STD then, which is now an STI. That means they cannot diagnose what sickness it is. So it's no longer diseases. It's infections. And he came, slept with mommy, gave her that sickness that caused my entrance into this world. It is amazing that I understand Joseph. When Joseph was sold into slavery and his brothers, they came for food, and Joseph looked at them and said, I remember what you did to me. The devil meant it for evil, but God turned it for good. When we understand that most of what we go through has nothing to do with us, we will better be able to appreciate that God has handpicked you to go through certain trials. But I will be honest, going through it is the hardest part. Because the very God, watch this, the very God who put you through it is not there. You see, it would be easy if at every step God said, don't worry, I'm with you. But you pray and there is no answer. You fast and there is no answer. But God is there. And he works in a mysterious way. And every time you read scripture that, and God gives a command, he never gives an explanation. He gave Joseph the dream and said, you will rule. But he didn't tell him.
This person, yeah,
the steps to get there. And it would be easy if God would come by my bed and say, Jeremy, next week you'll go through this. Don't worry about it, because the week after I will deliver you. And that is easy.
Yeah,
but when God is silent, and you are forced to trust Him, despite not hearing from Him, this is where it becomes challenging.
Yes.
And I was born, the doctor threw the undeveloped fetus away because a 5 months fetus cannot live. I remember sharing this testimony. You know, God have a sense of humor.
Yes.
I remember sharing this testimony in Florida, and a doctor who was there came to me and said, your mother lied to you. I've been practicing medicine for 50 years, and that is impossible. I said, okay, God bless you too, doc. Happy Sabbath. You don't allow people's shame to cover the ray of God's Son.
Amen.
Don't permit somebody else's lack of experience to overshadow your experience. Your experience is your experience. And I just said, okay, God bless you, sir, and happy Sabbath.
Yes.
And I moved on. Because listen to me, if everything can be proven by man, then God is absent.
Yes. Yes.
And I've learned that there are some testimonies it's best not even to share with human beings, because they can't understand. But God has a sense of humor. I remember I was leaving the Monday, it was the Sabbath, and I was leaving. We were on our way to the airport when the driver's phone rang, and the doctor was online asking the driver if I was with him. The doctor said, yes, he's right here, and he gave me the phone, and I said, hello, and he said, this is Dr. So-and-so. We spoke briefly, and so I said, yes, doc, I remembered. How may I help you? He said, my daughter, who is 5 months pregnant, she slipped, and I had to deliver the baby, and I am wondering if you can come by and pray from one fetus to the other. But I said, that must remember, that is impossible. Nothing can happen like that. You see, he has been practicing medicine for 50 years. But Jesus has never practiced medicine. The Bible says he is the great physician. And by him was everything made that was made. And so God does not need a textbook. He does not need scientific proving. He is God Almighty. And then there I went there because he must understand, you know, the human in me didn't want to go. You're too rude. But God says, go. Because Jeremy has nothing to do with you. It has nothing to do with you. So I went there, dressed me in this suit like I'm going to space. I went in, and there the baby was in this thing called an incubator. The baby is no bigger than this. And a lot of tubes connected. I had to be given like a presidential clearance for that.
Yeah.
I went in, I put my hands on the incubator, and I said, in the presence of the doctor, from one fetus to the other, thou shalt live and not die. And years later, that baby is alive. Big, healthy, bouncing baby girl. I need you to understand that the God that we serve. I remember mommy stole me from the hospital. I need to just sum it up so you can go home. You need to be here 4 o'clock tomorrow. So. Mommy stole me from the trash can and took me home. The police officers and nurses and social workers went home and said, you need to return hospital's property. And 8 days later, Mommy didn't do that. She didn't listen. And 8 days later, she had to take me back to the same hospital where she met the same doctors and everybody. And this time, the fetus is in need of a blood transfusion. When they called the blood bank, there was no blood at the blood bank. And when my sister said, when he was conveying this news to the family, his phone rang and said, "We found the blood."
Amen.
It is a blood that is not yet screened. And he was explaining to my mother what danger and the risk are if you give a newborn, much less an undeveloped fetus, this unscreened blood. Mommy said, "Give it to him. It is already screened by heaven. Give it to him." Woman of faith. You see, faith, I don't think the church understands faith. If you know how it will work out, it is not faith. Faith is when you don't see anywhere. And you wake up one day and there is a way. You can only say to God, "Be glory." That is faith. When there is no way out, and then God shows up. And so the doctor was amazed after he did the blood transfusion. He finished about 11 o'clock p.m. that night. He said, "You guys can go home," because at midnight that day, 1 hour after midnight when they went to check, the fetus was still alive. The doctor was amazed. He got on the phone with Jamaica and Guatemala to have the fetus transported to see how long on medication a 5 months fetus can really be. But Mommy wouldn't have that. Mommy said, "I'm taking my baby home. This is not a guinea pig or a lab rat. I'm taking my baby home." And so, because of the nature of the case and this woman's track record of being a thief, they called the police station, who sent a police officer to stand guard at the door so that this woman wouldn't steal this baby a second time. You know, it's amazing thinking about it. I was protected from, I was a child. Presidential protection. And Mommy, who is determined to have her way, went to the ward next door, caused a commotion. The police officer was distracted. Mommy walked right past it, picked up her baby and went home. Police came and the saga continued a year after. She had to take me back to the same hospital and met the same doctor. The doctor said, "Don't get too attached. At the age of 2, he'll be totally crippled because his bones were not properly developed. At the age of 3, he'll be totally blind. At the age of 4, he'll be a complete retard. At the age of 5, he will die."
God has the final
say,
brother.
Yeah. But I am still here. To tell somebody here tonight, I don't know what you are going through. I don't know what is going on in your life. I don't know, you've been crying for God to help, and God is silent. I am here to tell you, He is right there.
Yes, amen.
He is right there, and He who began a good work will complete that work. And there is so much more, but I will call it again for the second invitation. But I will tell you this: I am a high school dropout. I did 3 weeks in first form at still orientation, and I stopped school because the struggles were real. No finance, it was just starvation at school. It was difficult. And in an effort to help Mommy, I stopped school long before she knew, because I would dress in my uniform and leave, but I don't go to school. And in that quest to help Mommy, I became a DJ after the church mistreated us, when we wouldn't be permitted to sit in this Seventh-day Adventist church. Because adults and young people would stretch their feet over the bench as an indication not to sit here. One lady said to Mommy, "You're wearing the skirt that I put in the bag. I hope you don't wear it more than I need." It was very difficult. And we stopped church, I stopped school, I became a DJ, but realized this, I'm still a Seventh-day Adventist.
Amen.
Because it is not about people, but about God.
Amen.
It is not about how you treat me. You don't have to like me.
That's right.
My experience with God is sufficient. And anybody that comes here to be liked, soon and very soon you will find yourself on the outside. Because church is not about liking. It's a group of people who have an experience with Jesus Christ. And even when you come here and there are battles to be fought here, it is not for you to leave. It's for you to fight and win right here, right in the camp. And I tried every denomination, every church, every religion, even Rastafarian. I was a Rasta. Until I found out that a Rasta is really a answer to a question that was asked. When they were looking around and they see the Europeans and everybody with their white Jesus, with their white God, the question was asked, where is the black man's God? That's when Haile Selassie, who has a white parent but a black, white and a black, you know, he's mixed. He took up the lineage, he held fast then rather to that of the black lineage. And he came and he is a believer in Jesus Christ. He is not Jesus Christ. He never claimed to be Jesus Christ. He promoted Christianity. When I came in contact with this, I was like, wow, if he promotes Jesus, what am I doing worshiping him? And so that's why I am here, back here, and I have no intention of leaving. As long as God holds me, I'm not holding him, but as long as God is holding me, I will not go anywhere. And today, I began by telling you that I'm a high school dropout. I did 3 weeks in high school, but today I hold a bachelor's in theology.
Amen.
And with the help of God, I am pursuing higher studies. How did this happen? I thought you would have never asked. It's going to be short, less than 5. But I feel it is important to encourage somebody who is a, you believe there is no hope for you, you can't listen to me. 12 years after dropping out of high school, 12 years passed. The Lord said, okay, by this time I was rebaptized, I am back in the church. That's why I advocate for rebaptism, because I'm a product of rebaptism. And there is no limit to the amount of time you can be rebaptized, it's just rebaptism. And your experience should lead you to that place. All right, are you with me?
Yeah.
And so I came back to the Lord, and the Lord said, okay, I'm preaching everywhere now. And the Lord said, okay, Jeremy, it's time for you to go and study. I thought that you just need to get on the phone with a university and tell them that God says it's time for you to go and study. And the university, you know, they will tell you to come. So I called NCU and I told them what the Lord told me. And they said, we need a high school degree. I said, no, I don't think you understand. The Lord told me that But I'm an old man now, I can't go back to first form and sit with children and laugh after children jokes. I can't do that again. I said, Lord, I will not do that. But we see things one way, but God have another way. So the Union back home was getting ready to open their theological school. And so they wanted a face for the department, and everybody knew me. I was a preacher everywhere, and they said, so we want you to be that face. Now, this is at a junior college level. This is at a college level. You would need to go through high school in order to reach here. So they said, we want you to be the face. And so I said, okay, sure. I went there. I spoke with the dean of the college, and he said to me, he said, where is your high school diploma? I said, I don't have it. He said, okay, just go into class. When you get it, you bring it. And I was like, okay, this is a dean of faith. This dean has a lot of faith. Then later I understood that he didn't understand what I said. He thought I didn't have it on me there and then, but I literally didn't have it. 2 years after studying, they graduated with honors. Because I've been praying for years, and I said, Lord, just give me one more time.
Yes.
And I promise you, God, I will not waste it.
Amen. Amen.
Graduated with honors, I called back NCU. I said, well, I have a higher degree than high school. This is a college degree.
Yeah.
They said, we're happy for you, but we still need your high school diploma. I said, good God, you put me through all that. But the Lord never begins something that he cannot fix. He said, Jeremy, go back to the same high school. Speak to the principal. Share with him what is going on. And I went there and I shared with him. And he said, Jeremy, I will help you. I said, really? He said, yes. I said, but I can't go in class and, you know, for all these years anymore. He said, after senior transcript and these grades, I it's hard to believe that you didn't finish high school. He said, so I will give you an exam. If you pass it, you get your high school diploma. I said, okay, give me the exam right now. He said, no, I will give you a study guide. I said, no. You might die, and the next principal might not be so gracious. Give me the exam now. You know, you see, there was a method to that madness too. If you catch the teachers off guard, they can't give you a complicated exam. They can just put an exam together. And so they put the exam together, they gave it to me that day. I did it, got all A's, and I, in half an hour, 45 minutes, I finished high school. There is nothing impossible with God. Now, I'm not telling nobody to drop out of high school and then expect this to happen. You know? I am saying that wherever you are right now, you're still within the blueprint of Almighty God, and He will still deliver each and every one of you. And it would be remiss of me, I'm taking my seat now. But I must say, when I got to Jamaica the first time, I took a taxi. I did not know the rules of Jamaica and that you shouldn't just take a taxi. So I came out and a guy said, sir, you looking for a taxi man? I said, yeah. And if my accent wasn't strong enough, I went on to tell him, you know I'm not Jamaican. You know I don't even know where I'm going. Like, sometimes I wonder how my brain works the way it does. But the guy said, oh, I know where in Northern Caribbean University is. That's my alma mater. And I felt like I was in the hands of God. I called NCU. I spoke to Mrs. Welch, who is in charge of international students. And she said, okay, it was 1:45 p.m. She said, okay, Jeremy, you will be here in about 2 hours the most. 3 hours passed, and I was not at NCU. Some time after that passed, and I looked up and there was a sign that says, welcome to St. Elizabeth. I've never been in Jamaica, but something said Mandeville, and Saint Elizabeth, they're not the same place. And so I called Mrs. Welch. I said, "John, where are you? We've been waiting here to receive you and everything." I said, "I don't know. I just passed a sign about 15 minutes ago that says, 'Welcome to St. Elizabeth.'" She screamed and she said, "Let me speak to the driver." He would not take the phone. So I put the phone on the speaker and she gave him some good patois. And he turned back to Mandeville. When I reached Mandeville, it was pitch black, it was dark. Securities were there, they were getting ready to, you know, put out an APB or something. And I came there, and the driver was getting ready to pay him, and he took half the money. And he gave me the other half. And he said, "Never do that. Never just get into a vehicle like that." He said, "But you don't have to worry. Because you never travel alone." I don't know what he saw or who he saw, but it is important to leave your home with Jesus. So that when trouble assail you out there, you will have had Jesus with you already. And you know, God is so good, you know. I think God was about to do something earlier, but I panicked. What am I trying to say? Because he was taking me to St. Elizabeth. My wife is from St. Elizabeth. So I tell my wife, he was just taking me to her. But I panicked and I, you know, but the Lord who had the gift for me still waiting and give me that gift. I'm trying to tell you, even when your life takes a detour, hear me, even when your life take a detour, God is getting ready to bless you. Wife, can you just stand up? Just stand up. Even when your life take a detour, God is getting ready to bless you. You can sit down. So I want you to know that as we go into 2020, don't go in 2020 wondering if God is able. He is able and He is available. May you trust Him, for it is time to do things. We are the hands of God. We are the Father's hands. Be patient with our loved ones. Be patient in the church. Love each other. For love is the fulfillment of the commandment. Can you stand with me, please? I just want to pray with you. Thank you for tolerating me for so long. And I pray that you are blessed.
Yes, amen.
And I pray that you invite me back for a 4-week crusade where we can impact the lives of others. For the greatest joy for heaven is to see others saved in His kingdom. Tonight, just before I pray, we'll have a special song. You can be seated. After this song, we will pray.
Good night. It's hard to tell when I don't know the way. Each turn is so uncertain. I learned to walk by faith. But you gave me a promise that you will never leave. You will lead and guide me. Lord, I do believe. Lead me, Lord. I will follow. Lord, I will go. You have called. never need to fear. For though at times I feel alone, I know that you are near. My heart just longs to follow. I'm willing to obey. Take my hand and lead me. I'll follow all the way. Lead me, Lord. I will follow. Lead me, Lord. I will follow. You have called.
External but internal. And as you go through 2020, you pray for me, for there are times when my organs malfunction, when they all just act up. Some of them stop working. But I believe that it is a thorn in my flesh to keep me at the feet of Jesus.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
Many of your thorn cannot be seen.
Yes.
And folk judge you.
Oh my God.
They don't understand that some days you can't even stand yourself.
Mercy.
And yet they are jealous of you. Not understanding that there is a thorn in the flesh. I want to thank God for all of you who came tonight. The musicians. Thank you. I want to thank God for Keith Bryant, who took us around and have restless nights because he's looking after us. Father, thank you, Keith, my friend. From me and my wife, and I want to thank God for my wife.
Amen.
To be married to me is not an easy thing at all. That's why she was handpicked.
Amen.
By God Himself. Shall we pray? Tonight, you're here and you want to have a deeper relationship with the Lord. You want to recommit your life to the Lord. I won't ask you to come. I stay right where you are and have an experience with Jesus right where you are. I'm going to give you a couple seconds to just telling the Lord what you want. But don't close that prayer without saying nothing.